Many Jamaicans believe that colorism and classism that ensued as a legacy of colonial past is still having a ripple effect on our Jamaican society today, and the majority ethnic group of Jamaicans are the people who are suffering the most from this colorism, classism, and hierarchical structure that was set up in Jamaica at the turn of our independence. And we're going to look at that in more detail in this video.
Drum from family, the drum from family, yeah. Drum fam, come hang with me.
Hello, 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 Wagwan. Big up yourself, whether you're there yard or you're there abroad. Welcome back to another episode of Life with the Jam Fams. Now, in this video, we're going to be taking a look at the primary thing that at this moment in time is still keeping Jamaicans oppressed. And we're starting off with thinking about the way in which we look at the construct of our Jamaican society. Now, many Jamaicans will tell you that they feel that they are disenfranchised and disempowered, as we spoke about in one of our previous videos. And we find a lot of comments that comes on and talk about that and are opposed to the motto of out of many, one people. Now, in various ways, these opinions are appreciated and valued because it gives us an insight into how the rest of us are thinking. And it's okay that we have different perceptions and different outlook on life. What we're going to do is to try and see how we can have a look at understanding some of the constructs that are around us and the things that they mentioned in these videos. And that's what I'm going to be talking about. Now, it's worth remembering that as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And the way in which we think is also the way in which we're going to act, operate, and behave. And so when we understand different people's opinions, we get an understanding also into the way in which they operate. And so we're going to start off with thinking about some of the things that people talk about significantly. One of the things they talk about significantly is the impact of the colorism and the classism and how that has impacted Jamaica. Now, significant numbers of people have worked through the ranks and are now in places and positions that they have not been before at the start of our independence, and that is increasing. And so what we want to do here in this moment is we want to take a look at some of the things that people have highlighted as issues that they have a concern with. And one of those things is to look at the fact that people highlight that Europeans or people of European descent, people of Chinese descent, and people of Indian descent, who are the minorities in the population, tend to occupy more of the businesses and also corporate positions. Although the Bantu groups in Jamaica, who are the Jamaican Israelites, more commonly known as Bantus, are increasing in numbers in these spheres, it is clear that a lot of the executives in organizations and a lot of the businesses that are thriving and are doing exceptionally well are from the groups of people who are within the minority. And we're going to focus on some of the other things that they raise as their concerns. Many people talk about the fact that the people who were here initially, who came as indentured laborers, who have been here for years, and are generations of them who have been born in Jamaica and are Jamaicans, have experienced the privileges of certain esteem in life because of their class and their color. And also, they have mentioned the fact that these people tend to stick together and practice what's referred to as nepotism. And also, the other thing that they've highlighted is the fact that the new people who are arriving have business graces that are given to them by legislation in our government system in terms of taxation relief that they get, that people setting up businesses in Jamaica, even if they're from similar groups, do not benefit from. And that in itself is also a disadvantage to the people who are actually Jamaican and who were born here and of Jamaican descent in whatever way or form. Now, it's worth remembering that we exist in a democratic capitalistic society, which at no point is it any reflection of equality. And therefore, we understand that the nature of those types of government systems will make life unfair. And we then have to look at what are some of the other things then that we can actually change or can adjust. It is also important to understand that this infrastructure and this hierarchy of way of living was not set up by these people, although they are the ones who, as alluded by many of the comments, are benefiting from such a system and such a hierarchy that has been established. And so no one is going to quickly give up their privileges because somebody else feels disadvantaged. It's like the phrase that people often use to other people to say, sharing is caring. Well, if you really think about it, sharing is caring only for the person who is benefiting from that sharing. It's not necessarily so for the person who is needing to do the sharing. And so it's worth understanding that in the same way, people are not going to want to necessarily relinquish their positions of privilege that they have simply because somebody else feels that they're being disadvantaged. In a system of democratic capitalism and the frequent use of meritocracy makes it even more so of a problem, because people who are in their positions of privilege are going to feel that they got there because of the merit, because they got there by merit, because they work, their effort and their work that they've put into it. And equally, they'll feel that people who aren't there are there because of their lack of effort or lack of work that they've put into it. We know very well that a lot of people who are facing poverty aren't necessarily there because they're lazy or because they haven't worked hard. It's simply because of some of the constructs and the level of education and understanding that they have of how to work through the systems in which they're living. Which brings us to the point of contemplating what is it that they do well that we could emulate that would work to our advantage. Because we know that if these are principles that exist, principles aren't biased. Principles work for people who work the principles. So it's worth exploring what principles are they implementing that we could also emulate. And we're going to look at some of those. So one of the first things that we can look at is the scope of equal opportunities. Because if we're utilizing those equal opportunities that are common to all of us, then it will give us a leverage that we need. So firstly, some of the equal opportunities. Education in Jamaica is free for everybody, all the way up until sixth form. And even thereafter, there are some provision of government-funded education that makes it way more economical for people. There are also the PATH program that helps to support people who would consider themselves to be disadvantaged so that they are better able to climb out of those scenarios by making good use of the equal opportunities that they have. We do know that there are lots of many things, factors that impact people's ability to become literate and numerate, and then being able to acquire the qualifications that are required in order to make it into exiting for career pathways that will be able to bring them into that social echelon that they're looking to aspire to. However, that's a pathway that is considered an equal opportunity for everybody. And so every individual should be able to access that at their capacity and in their level. The second thing to look at is the social choices of people in these groups. Now, people in these groups, when you see them out, if you consider that they're wealthy, you will not know it by the way that they carry themselves, because by their very appearance, they make the choice to look poor. And so they dress in a way that other people would consider to be poor. And they do things with their money that is actually going to increase their wealth portfolio and not use it to accessorize how they look and give people the impression that they're wealthy. And their other social choice that they make is the way in which they socialize with people. They make sure that they socialize with people who not just they can profit, but they can profit from. And so they build a network of like-minded people who are aspirational and want to get to places and want to do so morally. The other part of their social choice that we want to look at is that the majority of those people do not have children until they are married. And the other factor of that is when they're married, they have children, but also they do not have a large number of children beyond the means that they can actually care for. And so they tend to have families that are built up of one, two, or three children because they want to be able to give those children their undivided attention and invest enough time, effort, energy, and money into those children so that they can become significantly better and more advanced than they are and that they would ever be, because they want to ensure that their generations are growing and growing exponentially. Now, statistics have proven that in a household where there are both parents, children are more likely to do significantly better than in a household where there is only a single parent. And even when the father is present and inactive but present in the household, children are still more likely to do better than when the father is absent completely. In fact, the research has also shown that single household with fathers, children are more likely to do better than single household with women. And a significant number of Jamaican households tend to be matriarchal because they have mothers at the helm who are having to do all of the different things that are necessary for the fundamental development of their children. If you compare that to those other family groups, they have a mother and father present and even extended families to provide the necessary support that they need. Equally, they tend to be groups that are family-centered, and as mentioned before, they tend to have extended family, but also they work together collaboratively with their family, and they have collective responsibility, not just for their children, but for building businesses and building financial wealth for generations to come, because they're purposeful and intentional at working together to make sure that they can thrive. Now, people might say about this to highlight the nepotism that I mentioned earlier. Now, every single group on earth practice nepotism. It's about self-preservation and wanting to maintain your offspring and wanting to maintain your culture and your traditions. Now, a lot of Bantus that have been spread out across the world have somehow lost this, and they've lost this because of intentional so doing by the colonial powers that have been. And therefore, their nepotism tend to be less so because they were taught how to fight and destroy each other. This was intentional because they know that if people are working together as a team and collectively and collaboratively, it would help to advance them as a group of people. But if you notice when you go to other countries, the same nepotism, you will see that in the UK, in London, there is Chinatown. In New York, there is Chinatown. In lots of different states in America, you will find Chinatown. In Canada, you will find Chinatown. In many countries across the world you go, you will find Chinatown. Equally, you will find areas or hubs that are Indian oriented or that are Arab oriented. And you also find that you go to places where you find clusters of Jamaicans or Caribbeans, or you find Hispanics or Italians. It's not something that is just common to Jamaica. People across the world, wherever they migrate to, tend to get in a place where they get together and they form this structure because they can identify with those people. There are so many similarities with them. So it becomes a natural phenomenon for them. And part of that family-centeredness helps to build business and then build out generational wealth. It is something that as a group of Bantu Jamaicans, we also need to learn how to do. Learn how to do it better, because it's imperative that we do so. It's a big platform for us to be able to leapfrog into the future that we are trying to aspire to achieve. And it will require a lot of emotional intelligence, understanding that we are human beings with feelings and emotions, and understanding how to manage those emotions and the emotions of other people around us, understanding how to be forgiving and how to work together constructively for the development of each other. This is not to say it's absent in our society, but it is not as prevalent as it is in other ethnic groups within our country. The next thing we need to think about as well is group economics. Now, if you notice with the groups that we see that are constantly the ones opening businesses and setting them up here, they work as a group. They come as a group of people. Some of them are cousins, some of them are siblings, some of them are just friends, family friends that have been close together for a number of generations. And they come and they pull together, they work together, and they tend to stay together as nuclear units and build out into series of nuclear units that create extended family. And they group their funds together and they work through it. They do have disagreements. They do have problems within their groups, and they solve them as a group within the group, because their greater vision is more important, which is the fact that what they're doing, they want it to speak for generations to come and impact their children, their children's children, and they want to set up a legacy that is going to speak far into their future. And therefore, they recognize that the problems that they have need to be resolved in order to realize that dream and that ambition. And so it's something that is worth emulating. So for example, if they're going to set up a business and they're going to set up a food shop, and they realize that this food shop is doing well, instead of another one coming and setting up a food shop just opposite where they're competing for the same audience of people, the same clientele, what they would rather do is work together and put their funds together so that they can get that one place to a big enough establishment that they can then say, okay, we've established this well enough, we're going to copy and paste elsewhere. So we're going to make a number of these stores across this locale and then start to go wider afield. And in so doing, they're actually using good business model to build out their business, where they're not competing with each other, but instead creating a form of a monopoly where people are looking to them for their service, and they're not dividing their client base. When we think about it, the equal opportunities, the social choices, the family-centeredness and the group economics, all of these things brings us to this one ultimate thing that they do, and it is that they consider planning for their future as a paramount part of their existence, and they are happy to delay gratification so that they can fulfill these plans. They are intentional about it. They want to make an impact, and they want to make a lasting impact that speaks far into the future. And understanding it is that these people are coming from areas of severe weather conditions and different levels of severity that demand that they plan for the future, and so they are more adept at doing it. Bantu Jamaicans are coming from a period of colonization where the most that they were required to plan for was to go out each day to fulfill their duty of servitude. And once that was eliminated from our construct, not a lot of us have put in the measures, the effort, and the drive to transform that into ways where we are planning for long distance time. People do short-term planning where they plan to the end of the week, or they plan to the end of the month, but not many of them are planning for the next 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years into the future. And that is something that is required if we're going to make significant leaps and bounds to become better at what we do and to take up our positions and our place and get the respect that we deserve and the attraction that the progress that we will then find will also bring. So, of course, we started a little bit of a thing going out and getting that bubble tea today, because we paid for the bubble, which is the boba, but of course we didn't get it. Instead, we got the
coconut jelly
in there, which it comes with. The drink came with that. And so that's what we got. So we decided to get the boba and came home and going to make some ourselves, because we want that experience. And Eliona wanted the, which one did you want?
Either the chocolate or the oat milk.
So she wanted the milk chocolate or the oat milk. So she's decided that she's going to make herself the milk chocolate. And so what's your drink?
Mine is the chocolate milk, and yours is coconut and chocolate milk, because you wanted coconut.
Mm-hmm. And what did you put on yours?
I'm going to put marshmallows.
Okay. And they are vegan marshmallows, vegetarian marshmallows, because they're made with pectin rather than gelatin.
Mm-hmm.
And she also has, wait for it,
boba.
Boba! So it's boba time. And for those people who are saying about boba, we do know that boba is made from sugar or molasses, depending on what the people make it with. However, we haven't had it in a long time. The last time we had it, we made it ourselves because Eliona wanted to experiment with making it and she had missed it. And so today we decided that we're going to go and have some. And it's lovely. So it's a nice little taste on the taste buds to remind us of our tea moments in the UK. Mind you, we normally have it with fruit tea instead, though, isn't it?
Yeah. And I normally get popping boba.
Yes, and we miss the popping boba. We haven't come across one of the shops here yet that sells popping boba. Hopefully we'll see one soon. So I'm going to go drink mine.
Well, here's another surprise.
Mm-hmm. What's that? Oh! Yes, because the last time we didn't have boba straw, it was a struggle to drink it when we made it, didn't we?
And then turn the straw.
Uh-huh. And now we can just drink it because Madame decided she was going to order boba straw from, was it from Timo?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so do I have to choose a color?
Yeah.
Oh gosh. Okay, which color do you think I'm going to take?
Purple.
I'll tell you. Yep, that's the color I want. And I'm going to have my drink, just like that. Thank you, ma'am. Wow, that looks very foamy. I like it. Oh, okay.
I think I'm going to choose light blue.
Okay. And thank you so much.
No problem.
Mm-hmm.
the dancing family. Where I reap, live in the good life. We're royal, cruising through the West Indies, having fun, enjoying the good life. Dancing family, the dancing family, yeah. Dancing. Come hang with me.
Hopefully, this has addressed some of the issues and the concerns that have been raised in the comment section and also become a point of reflection for some of the people who are reading those comments and watching our content. Thank you again for staying here with us on this another episode of Life with the Jam Fams. We appreciate and value you, and we would like to hear your views and your take in the comment section below. Please remember to keep it respectful, because we are all entitled to our opinions and our perspective, and we can share them with respect by understanding how other people view things and not seek to be disrespectful in the way that we share ours or address theirs. Thank you again for staying with us here on Life with the Jam Fams. Bye for now, and we will see you in the next one.